So we have designed this form to add a new listing in our previous video. In this video, we will add a few more CSS to give this tab and property preview a better look. We will also conditionally hide these icons on this preview. And then we will understand how to group these controls on different tabs so that each tab can be validated independently. So first of all, let's add the CSS to improve the look of this tab control. As we are going to use this tab control on other forms as well, let's create a CSS file in the asset folder that we are going to add globally in our styles. I already have created these styles and let me paste it here. This is a simple CSS file where we have added a few classes that we will add in our tab control to change the border, color and hovering styles to the various elements generated in a tab control. I'm not going to explain it line by line. If someone has any question, you can ask through comment or you can send me a mail. Let's save it and add the required classes in HTML template of add property component. There are only two classes we need to set. First one here at the top level div called tab panel. This class will add some border around the panel. And second one here at tab set level. And name of class is member-tabset. We have not yet added our tab.css in global style sheet. Let's import the same here in styles.css. Save it and see. Now a border is added around our tab control. And when we are hovering over these tabs, this gray line is appearing at the bottom and the selected tab is appearing in blue color. Let's add some styles to this header as well to match with our theme. As this CSS belongs to the forms, add the same here in our form.css. We want to give h1 a white color that is defined under .card-header class. Suppose we need to give h2 and h3 as well a white color. We can add the same comma separated like this. Let's also add some styles to the card header. Set height 42 pixels. Let's add padding 4px for top and bottom and 10px for right and left. Add hyphen important here to give high priority to this CSS. Although you should not use this important in your CSS, but sometimes we need to be rigid to apply our CSS forcefully at some level without respecting the specificity. I have provided the link of an article about when using important is better choice for your knowledge. Save it and see how it looks. No change. Let me check where the issue. Yep, here is spelling mistake in the class name. Let's correct it. So now it's matching with our theme and it has also changed on our property preview as well. Let's add some minimum height to this preview as well because it looks awkward when height keep increasing and decreasing of this control at runtime. As this class specifically belongs to our property card component only, let's add this CSS here in property card CSS file. So now the height of this control is set to minimum 400px and it will not keep expanding and shrinking at runtime. Let's add some shading around this property preview. We can use bootstrap classes name shadow lg. Lg means here large. There is also another CSS named shadow-sm for small shadow. Add some padding and give the background a color white. So this shadow is added, but the card is not aligned with its heading. Let's check where the issue. Seems the problem is here. Let me take this property card out of div. Perfect. It's now aligned to the header. Let me add shadow to this box as well. Use the same bootstrap classes. This time keep padding 0 here because we already have added some padding to the tab control. So it's looking good. Next, we need to hide these icons from the property card if it is displayed here. But we still need these icons to be displayed on the listing page here. So how to do this conditionally, that it appear on the list page but not on add new listing form? You already know that we can define input property in our component to get the data from the parent component. Similarly, like this, we can add more input properties here. So let's add an input property named hide icons of type boolean that we can set in our parent component. And here in HTML template of our property card component, we can hide icons on the base of this input property, as this unordered list is where we are displaying these icons. We can use ngif here and display this list only when hide icon property is false. Now in our add property component, we just need to set hide icon property equals true to hide the icons. We can use property binding here if we need to get this value from any variable we have defined in TypeScript, or we can simply set its value without property binding if any static value need to pass here. Save it and see, icons are not displayed here on this add property card component, but we are getting icons here on our listing page. So this is how we can add input properties in our component to set the different configuration. Next, we'll add more fields on this property card preview. We have added a lot of fields related to the property card on this form, but at present we are just displaying these three fields on this property card, and also there is no proper label available here. Next, we'll add more fields on this property card and add some labels. We have this interface that we are using as a type on our property card component. Let's copy this and add a new interface iProperty base to define the basic fields. Now we have two types. One is a furnishing type and another one is property type. Let's add one more type here for furnishing type and define P type for the property type. Add a few more fields that we are going to display on our property card. BHK for the number of bedroom, hall, kitchen, built up area, city, RTM to define if property is ready to move or not. So these are the basic fields we will use for our property card, and we do not need to take all the fields related to the property in one interface. We can take the benefit of TypeScript inheritance to extend any interface. First, we can create a generalized type as we have created iProperty base, and then we can add more fields using extend method on existing interface to make more and more specific type as per our requirements. For example, just add one more field in this extended interface. We will add more fields in this interface in our next video, and we will use this extended interface to define a class to store all the data of this form in local storage. And if we use this extended version of interface in our add property component here, this is giving error here because in our new interface this has been renamed to P type. Here you can see we are getting all the fields of our base interface, and also this description field we had defined in our extended interface as well. This was just to show you an example of how the extended interface will have properties of both base and the extended interface. We are not going to use this interface for property view. Instead, we will use iProperty base here because we just need to use basic fields on this property card preview. Initialize all the mandatory fields as null. We'll set these properties using two-way data binding. Let's replace the same for input parameter in our property card component as well. So compiler started to give error for type field because it is no longer exists in our new interface. We will fix all these errors step by step. Let's change it to ptype here in our property card component. Here on list page as well, property type is not appearing. And the reason is this data is being displayed from this property.json file. And here we need to rename it to ptype. We can change all the references in one go by using Ctrl plus F2 and change it to ptype. Perfect, it's back now. Let's check if it is working fine in our add property component. Nope, property type is not appearing here. And the region must be same. We need to change this from type to ptype. It's working fine. And now we can remove this older interface and we will continue to use this new interface further in this project. I have updated this properties.json file and added all the required fields we are going to use in this project and also added some dummy data. I have provided the link to this JSON file in description. You can copy and paste in your project. Let's also update this property card HTML to add more fields we have added in our property base interface. I already have created this HTML. Let me paste it here and explain what I am doing here. So this is just plain HTML. You can easily understand. There is nothing complicated in this HTML. I have added all the fields that we have defined in interface and a few ngif statement. For example, this ngif I have added to add comma after property name if property name exists, and this ngif to concatenate a word furnished if the furnishing type is not unfurnished, and this is horizontal line, added price and area info at the bottom of this card, and these few classes I have added to add some margin at the top and bottom. Let's save it. So this is how our property card finally looks. I will also add Google fonts and change a few fonts on this property card in our next video. Let's see how it appears on our add property card component. So we are getting just blank labels here. At present, only three fields are binded on this form. Let's bind other fields as well. Let me copy this and little lazy, don't like to type each and every word. So paste it here and bind this BHK with property view.bhk field. And it is important to add name on each field whenever we are using ng model. Bind furnishing type. Name was already binded. Bind this city. Price binding was already done. And finally this built area. Save it and test. Perfect. So our form is designed and we have set up all the CSS and bounded all the required fields on this property preview. Next we need to add validation and save the data in local storage. So in our previous video we understood how to check validation at form level, but here information is divided into multiple tabs and we need a way to validate this form at each tab level. Let's add some validation at the first tab. Make this sell rent radio button a required field. And on submit click, we are already logging out on this form. So if we submit our form now, you can see we are getting all controls in a single object. And each control has a valid state to check if it is valid or invalid. And here we are getting this form level validation status. So in order to group all controls, Angular provides a directive called ng-model-group. We can use it here at tab level, and let's give it a name, basic info. If now we will submit our form, you will see here in control, now all the controls we have defined in first tab is grouped in this basic info form group. And we can now check the validation at tab level as well, in addition of form level. In template driven form, you already know we can define a template variable starting with hash to get the reference of any directive. Let's get the reference of this ng model group in a template variable and use it here to disable this button if data on first tab is not valid. You can see this next button is disabled because this tab is not valid as mandatory fields are not provided. At present, we have validation only on these two fields. And if we select this radio button and provide some value in this field, our next button get enabled. Because now all the required fields and validation are fulfilled for our first tab, so our first tab is valid, so this button get enabled. And to get the value of these fields defined in a group, we can access the same like this. Add property form dot value and name of our form group, and then we can give the name of control. So here we are getting the value of cellrent flag, and if we remove this ng model group name from here, it will return undefined. This is how we can group our control in template driven form and put a validation on that group. Next, we'll understand how to do the same in reactive form, and then we will save our form data in local storage, and we will display the newly added record on our list page. So see you next video. Stay tuned.